ॐ जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोः श्रुत्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः। नमस्ते एवरीवन, एंड आई एम हैप्पी टू जॉइन यू टुडे इन द कंटेम्प्लेशन ऑफ द मोस्ट प्यूरिफाइंग लाइफ ऑफ होली मदर श्री शारदा देवी, हु इज यू कैन से द वेरी पैरागन ऑफ ग्रेट वर्च्यूज, द एसेंस ऑफ इंडियन कल्चरल एंड स्पिरिचुअल वैल्यूज एंड हेरिटेज। सो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस दिस ग्रेट लाइफ एंड हर मैसेज टुडे, एंड एस्पेशली इन द लाइट ऑफ वेदांत। So whoever has selected this topic, my thanks to him for the simple reason that you helped me also contemplate on this great elevating life and her very inspiring messages, which are short but so potent, so intense. So today we will be, for the next about a few minutes, we will be contemplating deeply on her life, and then we will go into her message, and especially as how her message is essentially Vedant. We will be discussing this in the light of Vedant, how great were Mother's very simple messages. Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi was very simple. She embodied this, there was this unique blend of divinity and universal motherhood in her. So she comes to us as like a goddess, that pure, full of virtues, full of compassion, kindness, and at the same time, she has godly virtues. She is divine. She is transcendental, and yet a mother. So we have a combination of this entire thing, a beautiful blend of the highest in humanity and the expression of pure divinity. So this we have in the image of the Holy Mother, and that is why she is an instant appeal to any human heart anywhere. I have seen this. Today even you are asking about mother's life, about mother's message. So this only shows to what extent we have internalized mother. Millions of human beings in this world today literally worship her because she epitomizes the very best of human virtues, the very best of our spiritual heritage. This you will find in her life, the very many incidents of her life. They are very simple. You know how simple mother was? She was, you can say, deceptively simple. You do not understand her divinity apparently just like that, but just observe her life with a still mind and you will see that every incident is a pointer towards great truth, a great Vedantic truth. And that is why mother comes to us in very simple guise, for the simple reason that we can approach her. She is very approachable. We can approach her as simply as we approach our mother. So this is the uniqueness of Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi's life. I read in a very beautiful article, it was given a description of Holy Mother, that there was no goddess who was so motherly and there was no mother who was so godly. So this is a beautiful description of Holy Mother. Indeed, we have this picture in her, and that is why to even discuss about this great life, and in her case, the life is the message, to discuss about it, it has an ennobling effect on our psyche, on our heart. In all these divine personalities, let us remember, their life is their message. They don't stand at a podium and give separate messages, but their very life demonstrates the highest in that a human being can manifest. It demonstrates the nature of divinity. It gives us that heartwarming experience of deep faith in humanity, because they are expressing a great truth, a great virtue through a human form. So even if you look at mother's life, mother's physical form, you will see this, the feel of purity and stillness in her eyes, and the sense of universal motherhood that she radiated. Even from a very young age, Sri Sharda Devi could look upon every man, woman and child as her own child. So this shows the great mother mind, the universal motherhood of God. And she actually came to embody that. Sri Ramakrishna, Swami Vivekananda, all of them recognized her divinity. And that is why, in what words have they described it? Sri Ramakrishna used to say, Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi, she is Saraswati herself. Saraswati, who has come in this form to give knowledge to humankind. And Swami Vivekananda used to say that without mother power, there is no regeneration for the world. He used to say, without Shakti, there is no regeneration for this world. Mother has been born to revive that wonderful Shakti in India, and with her as the center, once more will Gargis and Maitreyis come out of this culture. So it is so very important to understand these statements which they have made about Holy Mother. Gargis and Maitreyis obviously would precede the Sitas and Savitris, isn't it? Because a foundation of great spiritual knowledge is required to manifest the highest values of human life. So it is so important to cultivate this spiritual knowledge, and Mother has come to give us that. This was Sri Ramakrishna's statement. She has come to bestow higher knowledge. What did Mother say about herself? She was as simple as our mothers are. And she would say, she never claimed to be a guru or a goddess. She would say, I am your mother. This she would say to everyone. And once she said, Sri Ramakrishna had the feeling of motherhood towards all creation. He had the attitude of a mother towards all creation. He left me behind in order to demonstrate this motherhood of God. So you see, in her own words, she is describing her purpose. She is describing what she has come for. She is describing her nature. And she is describing how we should relate to her. This great mother power has come to us in this form. And if you read her life, at some points in her life, at some places, she will actually send you into meditation, because the incidents of her life are so profound, so meaningful, so purifying. And that is why contemplating on this divine personality who came in such simple guise is itself a sadhana in itself. So we will be discussing some incidents from Mother's life. Let me go a little bit before that into the philosophical basis of this Shakti Tattva in Hinduism. Because to understand what Mother is, what this Mahashakti is, why we worship her, we should understand the place of Shakti, the place of energy in this cosmic design of this universe and in what we are calling God. Why God manifests himself as Shakti? Why is Mahashakti worshipped? For the simple reason, she is the energy behind the universe. She is the cause for all movement, action, energy. She is the cause. Whenever we are seeing something, hearing something, thinking, as long as we are bound to this senses, this mind, trapped in this body, it is only Mother that we can relate to. For the simple reason that she is the energy behind all of these functions. Without Shakti, Brahman cannot function. Pure consciousness comes into manifestation as life through the power of Shakti. And this is the importance of Shakti, the divine energy of this universe. So, Sankhya psychology tells us that the ultimate reality is a combination of Purusha and Prakriti. Purusha is pure consciousness, what we are calling Brahman in Vedanta. And Prakriti is what we are calling Shakti. She is the divine energizer of this universe. She is the energy which brings Brahman into manifestation as life. So you can relate to this great Mahashakti directly. This is the Shakti Tattva. The importance of Shakti in our own system has to be understood. Vital energy is responsible for your entire mind mechanism. Swami Vivekananda says thought itself, it is nothing but refined vital energy. So this vital energy manifests as your thought, your ideation, emotion, as your will. It manifests as everything. Movement is due to the presence of Shakti. Thought is due to the presence of Shakti. And That is why if vital energy leaves the body, then there is no manifestation of life. So this important point has to be understood. In the cosmic design, she is Mahashakti who enlivens consciousness and makes manifestation possible. In the life of Shankaracharya, the 8th century AD philosopher, there's a very beautiful incident which tells us about this Shakti Tattva and how Shankaracharya himself understood the glory of this Mahashakti. Shankaracharya was this incident happened in Kashi in Varanasi, and Shankaracharya was going towards the Ganges, the river Ganga, for his bath. And on the footsteps of a ghat, as he was proceeding, he saw a lady. It was a narrow lane, and there he saw near the ghat a lady sitting with a dead body beside her. And she was sitting, obviously he thought maybe it's her husband who has passed away. And this lady was sitting there and just looking at him. And as he came nearer, he requested her, "Mother, can you please move the body a bit so that I can go forward towards my bath in the Ganga." Now this lady immediately said that, "Well, it is you who claim that everything is Brahman. Only Brahman is, and all is Brahman. So then this also is Brahman. Why don't you ask Brahman to move?" This question stumped Shankaracharya. He immediately thought that this is no ordinary woman. She is actually trying to tell him that Brahman himself cannot move. It is only when Brahman is conjoined with Shakti, with vital energy, he becomes capable of life. Now vital energy has left. So although Brahman is there, he cannot manifest as life. So you see what a profound truth she is leading him towards. And then Shankaracharya understood this Shakti Tattva, the need for vital energy, Shakti, to manifest consciousness as life. Shiva becomes his entire manifestation, his creation, through the power of Shakti. All doing, thinking, feeling, willing, everything is due to the power of Shakti. And without Shakti, Shiva cannot move. Brahman is not capable of manifestation. So when he grasped this tattva, he immediately bowed down to that woman who was none other than Shakti herself, who had come to teach him in that form. So this is the great Shakti tattva of Hinduism, the importance given to this divine cosmic energy who is responsible for energizing everything. All divine personalities who have come from this culture, that is why they have been Shakti worshippers. They have understood the importance of this Shakti. Look at the life of Sri Ram. Any important incident in his life, he first worshipped Shakti. Even before the death of Ravan, he worships Mother Shakti so that he gets the power to defeat the demon king. Sri Ramakrishna was throughout his life a Shakti worshipper. And his entire life was dedicated to Mother Kali, as you know. So the importance given to Shakti is great in our culture. Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi, we look upon her as that very Shakti who came in a very motherly form. And that is why she holds within herself immense power. Sri Ramakrishna used to tell Hriday, who was his nephew, he would tell him, "Well, if you hurt this," which means himself, "you will still get forgiven for that. But if you hurt the being who is in her, in Sri Sharda Devi, even Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar cannot forgive you. They cannot save you." So it shows that the importance he is giving to Shakti. And in mother's life, she comes to us in very simple motherly guise, but she holds this great power because, you see, she has the power to actually manifest Shakti, divinity in a most sattvic form. And there is no expression even, no too much expression in mother. Have you seen this holding great power but yet not expressing it? This must be such a great capacity. So this capacity you find in the life of Sri Sharda Devi. She holds great power within herself, but hardly there is an expression of that power. She was the person who accepted the puja of Sri Ramakrishna, isn't it, during the Shodashi puja? She was the person who accepted the fruit of his entire sadhana, his entire tapasya. So this is the great strength that mother holds within herself, but she appears before us just as a mother in very simple guise. And that is why studying this life, we will actually see how mother's mind actually was merged in Brahman. It was riveted in the supreme truth, because she herself was Shakti. She was the manifester of that truth in this universe. So her mind dwelt in this. In the simple incidents of her life, you will see this again and again. Sri Sharada Devi's life shows this centeredness in Brahman. Her mind was steeped in God consciousness. There are so many incidents of her life which actually show this. And that is why even her central message is connected to this. She would say, learn to make the whole world your own. Nobody is a stranger. The world is yours. Everything is a manifestation of that Brahman only. At another place she says, he who is within me is verily within you. By doing sadhana, you understand this, that he who is within oneself is verily the one who is in all beings. So you see, these are all words which have come from that experience of oneness, of one unitary consciousness in this entire world of manifestation. There is one consciousness shining in different names and different forms. You see, when you see around you, you see only a world of manifestation, of multiplicity. But there is one underlying current of unity underlying this entire world of difference. And that is consciousness. One who touches this consciousness sees from within, as it were, sees the heart of things, as it were. And that is why you find such expressions. These are verily like words of the Upanishads. In the Kathopanishad, there is this beautiful mantra which says, Agnir yathaiko bhuvanam pravishto rupam rupam pratirupo vabhuva ekas tatha sarva bhutantaratma rupam rupam pratirupo bahishcha, which means, just like fire is the same no matter what the structure of the flame, isn't it? Flames can be very different, but it's nothing but fire. So also there is only one consciousness which appears to be different or modified according to the subtle bodies, according to the causal and subtle bodies of different beings. So it appears to be different, but it is the same fire. It is the same consciousness that is manifesting through all these names and forms. This is actually the recurring theme of the Upanishads. They are trying to show us the actual unity of all existence. Where does unity lie? It lies here in the perception of this unitary consciousness. Nityo anityanam chetanas chetananam eko bahunam. The verses of the Upanishads are constantly pointing us towards this, that there is an eternal substance in the midst of these perishing things around us. There is one conscious being interpenetrating and manifesting through all that appears conscious, and even all that appears unconscious. And that is this truth of Brahman, this truth of pure consciousness. So you see, Mother Sharda's words are on par with the words of the Upanishads, which is the very essence of our Vedas. Because a being of realization, a person who has had realization, actually perceives the essence of the scriptures. And you find this spectacularly in Mother Sharda's life. But she was very simple, and so she would not show the level of her realization. Let me give you an incident here which will help us understand Ma Sharda's nature. Once Yogin Ma, who was a close associate companion of Holy Mother, she visited her at Dakshineshwar. And Mother Sharda told her very simply, see, the master is in ecstasy day and night. Please go and tell him I also want a little taste of that ecstasy. I am also yearning for it. Please tell him this. Now, Yogin Ma went to the master and she made this appeal to him, that mother also wants to have ecstasy, what is called Bhava Samadhi. Then the master became very grave, because he knew the stature of Holy Mother, and he became very silent. When he would go into that state, nobody could speak much. So Yogin Ma then bowed down to him, and she came back slowly to the Nahabad, where Holy Mother lived in Dakshineshwar. As soon as she came to the Nahabad, she saw Mother was sitting in worship, but streams of tears of ecstasy were rolling down her cheeks. And in that radiant state, suddenly Mother started laughing and crying in turns. She was in a state of deep bhav samadhi. After a few minutes, she plunged into samadhi and became completely still, absolutely still and radiant with holiness and divinity. And Yogin Ma was stunned at this sight, and she just stood there, unable to speak anything. And after a long time, Mother came out of this state, and gradually she opened her eyes. As soon as she opened her eyes, she saw Yogin Ma standing there. And then she is telling her like a girl, "Did you tell Master about my request? Did you tell Sri Ramakrishna about what I requested?" And Yogin Ma said, "Mother, I saw with my own eyes you are already experiencing what you are asking for. You already are experiencing, Mother. And today I have seen it with my own eyes that Samadhi is your state. You are already in that state. So what are you asking for?" So this, then she has written this in her reminiscences, Yogin Ma. Because Yogin Ma and Golak Ma, who were the constant companions of Holy Mother Sri Sharada Devi, they saw these incidents in her life. They knew her worth. They knew that she was divinity incarnate, manifest in this very simple motherly form. When Mother was living in Dakshineshwar in the Nahabad, she would go up. I like this portion of Mother's life very much, because it appears to be like her sadhana period. But she's already imbued and soaked in divinity. She would go and sit for meditation very early in the morning at 3 o'clock. And at that time, once she heard somebody playing the flute, and it increased her longing for the consciousness of God, and she plunged into samadhi. She herself says this, that it increased my longing to such an extent that I experienced samadhi. Just somebody playing the flute near the Panchavati in the Dakshineshwar temple garden. There are so many incidents like this. In Nilambar Babu's garden house, Mother actually experienced Nirvikalpa Samadhi. So all these incidents, in Sri Ramakrishna's case, it was so apparent and obvious, his states of his mind. But Mother hides them. She does not show them clearly. And she only shows her motherly form, because she came with that purpose. And that is why her nature was like this, to hide her divinity and just show that she is the universal mother. It is due to this perception of unitary consciousness that Mother is able to say, "Ami satero ma, ami asatero ma." I am the mother of the virtuous and I am the mother of the wicked. See, this is no easy statement to make. She is the mother of all. A very wicked person, even his own mother may disown him, or his own mother will be hurt. But Mother is able to accept everyone, no matter how he or she is, as her own. And throughout her life, this is how she behaved. This is the individual attention she gave to every human being who came to her. To her Amjad, who was a petty thief, and the general secretary of the Ramakrishna order, Swami Sharadananda, were the same. In her eyes, they were the same. So this capacity comes only due to the perception of this unitary consciousness in all beings. The essential message of Vedanta is this: don't see the human being merely as body and mind, because he is not just body and mind. He is the spirit, the soul, the Atman, which is functioning through a body-mind complex. So when one realizes this divinity within oneself, one is able to see the same in others. And this was the clear perception of Ma Sharada towards everyone, and yet mixed with motherly love, motherly concern. So that is why we have this unique blend of the highest divinity and great motherliness in her. There is this beautiful incident which happened in Dakshineshwar. Mother would carry Sri Ramakrishna's plate of food to his room when it was time for his lunch. So when she would carry the plate of food, usually she would cook in the mornings, and then she would cover it and take it in great silence to his room. At one point, one lady came to her and she requested mother, mother, can I please take this food to the master? And mother said yes and handed over the plate of food to her. Now that lady placed the food in front of Sri Ramakrishna and left the room. Then mother came, mother would sit and fan the master and make sure that his mind did not plunge into samadhi, because then he won't be able to eat. So she would do this while the master ate. So when mother came and sat, Sri Ramakrishna immediately told her that, why did you send this food through her? Don't you know this lady does not lead a good life? How can I eat this food? Why did you send it through her? Then mother said that, I will make sure I bring the food next time, every time. But master, if somebody calls me mother, then I cannot hold myself. So if somebody addresses me as mother, I will have to hand over the food to her. I will have to do what she says. So please forgive me for this. And you must remember that you are not my lord alone. You belong to the whole world. Look at mother's perception. Look at her words. You are not my lord alone. You belong to the whole world. She is reminding him. And then without another word, Sri Ramakrishna started eating. He was very happy at these beautiful expressions of mother. Sri Ramakrishna rejoiced, because it showed that the purpose for which she came into this world, that was getting expressed. That was coming out of her naturally, spontaneously, in so many ways. There are very many such beautiful incidents in mother's life. There is that incident of the betel leaves rolls which she would make. See, this is a common practice in Bengal, that they eat betel rolls after lunch. It helps in digestion and all that. So mother would make these betel rolls for the master. And it was found that one day when a devotee was working with mother, she found that mother was making two sets of rolls. One with the ordinary spices, which they put in a betel roll, and the other one was being made with some special spice like cardamom added to it. And then this lady asked that, mother, why are you making two kinds of rolls? And look at mother's answer. She says, well, you know, this variety, which is ordinarily made, this I am making for the master, and he eats this type of roll, and these special ingredients I am putting for the new devotees who come to this temple garden. Because you see, they are newly coming. It is I who have to make them my own. That is why I am putting these special ingredients into these rolls. And for the master are these ones, the ordinary ones, because he is already my own. Look at the beautiful expression of mother. Whoever feels, you see, a young wife would naturally want to give the best to her husband. But look at mother's perception. Mother's idea was that everybody has to be made my own. That is why I say she had the capacity from a very young age to look upon everybody in this world as her child, as her own. And that is what she created such a, that is why the bond that we feel with Holy Mother. She was really the universal mother of all beings. In so many incidents of her life, you will find this is the dominant expression of her life. She would put everything aside to assert her motherhood. There is one incident which is really startling. One lady would come to the master, and she had a strange attitude towards the master, which was that of Madhur Bhav. So one day she came and behaved in some particular way which Sri Ramakrishna did not like, and he scolded her. He scolded her and he asked her to go away. Now this lady was weeping and wailing, and you know, mother says, well, why did she go to him? She should have come to me. I am there for my poor child. You bring her here. And when that lady was brought to mother, mother is telling her, see, if he is annoyed at your presence, don't worry, you come to me. I am there for you. you come into my company. Look at mother's expressions. Her divine motherhood dominated over everything else. That is why the normal dualities and the dual understanding of the human mind, these polarities of our mind, good, bad, right, wrong, small, big, weak, strong, all this did not exist. One bond of love engulfed everything. And that is why her actual perception of human beings was like that, making everybody her own. All types of people used to come to her in Dakshineshwar as well as later on in Jayarambati when she lived there. And she had this capacity to make everyone feel at home and feel like they have come into the lap of their mother. So what an enormous capacity is this in today's materialistic modern world. You see what an enormous huge message she has to give, that a personality like this existed. A personality like this could love in this manner. This itself is so ennobling, so purifying for us to know. And that is why she inspires the greatest devotion in us. Let me tell you another beautiful incident which happened in Jayarambati. There was this young boy called Nyan who used to come to mother. He had met mother at Udbodhan and he wanted to come to Jayarambati. So when mother went to Jayarambati, he came there. So he was a boy from East Bengal, very devoted but obstinate by nature. And this boy, when he came to meet mother in Jayarambati, one day she asked him, "Do you go to bathe in the Amodar river in the morning?" So there is that river Amodar where mother also used to go. And mother asked him, "Do you go there to bathe?" And he said, "Yes, mother, I go there." Then she said, "Well, tomorrow when you go there, take this basket and get me yellow flowers which are blooming on the banks of that river." There was a huge tree with bright yellow flowers. "So pluck as many flowers as you can and put them into this basket and bring it for my worship." Then Nyan was very happy. He was a young boy. So the next day when he went to the river, he climbed the tree and plucked a basket full of flowers and he brought it to mother. And when he came to mother's home, mother was sitting in worship, in the worship room. And so she signaled to him to place the basket there. And she signaled to him to sit down there. So Gnan sat quietly watching mother worship. And mother finished the worship of Sri Ramakrishna. And then she signaled to him to come closer. And then she whispered a mantra into his ears. She initiated him. So this blessed boy who did not even know and had not asked for initiation, he received the initiation mantra. And then mother told him, "My boy, now you bow down to Sri Ramakrishna." The boy immediately said, "But mother, you are my guru, I will bow down to you." And then mother said, "No, bow down to Sri Ramakrishna, he is the guru of gurus, I am your mother." Then this boy was obstinate by nature, so he said, "But you initiated me, you are my guru, I should bow down to you. As for my mother is at home." So actually then mother became stern and cut him short and said, "You're saying your mother is at home. Please look at me. I am that mother. Look at me. I am that mother." And to his great surprise, Gnan actually saw his biological mother sitting there. And he was totally taken by shock. And then he did not know what to do. And after some time again, he saw Holy Mother sitting there. So then he writes in his reminiscences, "That day I understood that she is the true mother of every being. She is the not only my mother in this birth, she has been my mother in every birth and she will always be my mother. And this is so for all creatures on this earth. She is the universal mother who comes as our biological mother to give us that particular bhav. She is that concentrated form of motherhood." And Gnan was, as it were, inundated with bliss and peace and joy at this knowledge which he received directly from mother. You know, there is a very beautiful song which describes Holy Mother as Nikhila Matru Hridaya Sagara Manthana Sudha Murati, which means if you churn the hearts of all the mothers in this universe. The pure nectar of love which you will get. She is the embodied form of that nectar. She radiated the supreme motherhood of God in all its aspects. And that is why this life, the life of Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi, is supremely purifying to contemplate upon. Even to think of it is uplifting, that such a being existed on this earth. About Gandhi, Einstein had once said that the future generations will refuse to believe that a man called Gandhi existed. What to speak of Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi, that such divinity and purity are a possibility, and in the human system, in a human being. This is really, that is why the divine incarnation comes, to give us this conviction, this faith, to arouse devotion in our heart, and to know that the greatest human values are a perfect possibility in the human life. They are not utopian ideals. They can be expressed. With the awakening of divinity comes all virtue, comes all, you can say, ennobling power into the human life. All nobility comes by itself. So Mother Sharda's life gives us this immense hope. She's actually a beacon of hope and light for all of us, and a perennial inspiration towards the greatest values of life. But she herself was so simple. Let me tell you this funny incident. Mother Sharda was once, when she was in the Udbodhan house, she asked one brahmachari whether he was frightened of ghosts. And he said, "How can we be frightened of ghosts? We are the children of the Divine Mother," which means she herself. And then Mother said, "But I am frightened of ghosts." She said, "You know, they make my stomach shrivel." And he laughed and said, "Oh, you are frightened of your own creation." Actually, he was also referring to her relatives, who were the people around her, sometimes were very bothersome and very irritating. But Mother tolerated and accepted everyone with love. So he was referring to them, and Mother said, "Yes, they make my stomach shrivel." So like this, very simple Mother was. All her expressions are simple and motherly. But within herself, there is the complete light of divinity, of pure consciousness, Brahman shining in full force. You can see this so clearly by some of her statements. Once when she was in Kashi, one Swami Arupananji Maharaj, he told her, "Mother, you know, I do not want Nirvana. I do not want Mukti," that means. "Why? Because then I will not have you. I always want this relationship of mother and son with you. So I don't want Nirvana." And Mother suddenly said, "My foolish boy, you do not know the nature of God is Nirvana." Which means my real nature is Nirvana. See, it's an outpouring of a tremendous spiritual truth, that the incarnation is established in Brahman, in God consciousness. That is why he is the incarnation. And he has this human aspects of him, but the divinity shines forth throughout his life, in every aspect of his life. So this we find in the life of Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi. Once when Mother was a little later in her life, when she used to suffer from rheumatic pain, a maid used to come and massage her feet with medicated oil. So that maid's name was Kamini. She would come daily and massage Mother's feet, and Mother would sit with her feet outstretched, as you see in the photo which we keep in our dining halls. So Mother would sit like that and she would massage the feet. Now one day a devotee entered Mother's room when this was going on. And Mother suddenly turned towards that devotee and said, "You know, the body is one thing, the mind is another thing, and the soul is another thing. But that soul pervades this body-mind complex. That is why I feel pain here." She showed her knees. That is where she had the rheumatic pain. And then she says, "But if I withdraw my mind, I will not feel this pain." See, the whole of Vedanta is there in this incident. The soul, the spirit, that is manifesting through this body and mind. It pervades the body and mind. But you have the capacity to withdraw the mind in such a way that it turns towards its own source, towards its divinity. And you can remain completely oblivious of the body-mind complex whenever you wish to be. This capacity the human mind has, because in your essential nature, you transcend the body-mind complex. She is giving out these utterances, these great philosophical truths in such simple ways, you see. This is how she explained this profound truth of Vedanta to this devotee. So in mother's life, you find such remarkable incidents. Take any of her messages and you will see the profundity of it. She once said, there is no treasure equal to contentment and no virtue equal to fortitude. Check your life and see, isn't this true? This is true of every human life. At some point in our life, we understand the truth of this. There is no treasure equal to contentment, because no matter what you bring into your life, after some time, the mind will be saying, what more? What more is there? So that is why contentment is to be practiced, and fortitude, deep inner strength, resilience, deep inner courage. This is to be practiced. And these are the actual treasures of life, mother says. Profound teaching in such simple words. Her last teaching is a real blessing. It's a great message for all of us. If you want peace of mind, do not find faults with others. Rather, see your own faults. Learn to make the whole world your own. No one is a stranger, my child. The world is yours. This was mother's last teaching, which she gave to a woman devotee. You see, these words are potent with meaning and so relevant to our lives. If you want peace of mind, check and see if you have this tendency to find faults and to any form of negativity. If it rules your mind, you will not have peace of mind. Rather, she says, see your own faults and learn to make the whole world your own. That is why love, kindness, service, these are not options. These are the ways of good living. These are the normal, standards or norms for a great life, or for a really good life, a fulfilling life. So mother's last message encapsulates the essentials of human fulfillment. And that is why each word of hers is very important. They are actually sentences meant for meditation. If you want peace of mind, do not find faults with others. This is meant for meditation. And that is why mother's life and message are intertwined. In her own life, what she practiced, that came out of her mouth. And her own life shows, you can say, the very essence of our scriptures. In one incident, mother tells us, let me tell you this incident and finally conclude this talk. This was the message which she gave to Swami Shantananji Maharaj, who was a great sadhu of the Ramakrishna order. He was a disciple of Holy Mother Sri Sharada Devi. So once she told him, look, my son, if there is any crisis in your life, do one thing. Deeply think of me. Go into solitude. Cut off from everything. Dive into your japa and meditation. Deeply pray to me. Keep your body and mind pure. And dive into spiritual practice. And if you deeply pray to me, if you are able to connect with me, you will get my response. Do not distract yourself for a few days, but dwell on this, on your japa and your meditation, your spiritual practice. And still, if you do not get my response, please see that your mind has not risen to the level from where you can hear my command, because I will definitely respond. One who prays to me wholeheartedly will definitely receive my response. You must lift your mind to that level. Now, this teaching of Mother, it is something which all of us need, which all of us can practice in our lives, whether there is any crisis or not. If you lift your mind to Mother, that itself will answer all your queries, will bring deep peace within you. All that the human life can offer, the fulfillment which human life can offer, you can bring into your system, you can bring into your experience, if you can connect like in this way with this divine personality. This is Mother's great you can say hope, message of hope for all of us. She was a beacon of hope, inspiration and light. And with this message, I would like to conclude today's talk. Let us pray to Holy Mother Sri Sharda Devi that these beautiful incidents of her life and her inspiring messages come live in our own lives, and we are able to tread her path, follow in her footsteps towards the supreme ideal of life. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Jai Ma.